You're doing the tech guy thing because you're a tech bro, and we're going to
No,
talk about
oh
that.
no, 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 no. Le, au contraire, mon frère.
I'm Michael.
I'm Chris.
And we're Breaking Impossible.
Yes, we are.
All right. So today I want to talk about biological age and stress. Ordinarily, we talk about our travel and time on the trails and our training and the things I think that we're doing, at least partly try to live longer and live healthier. At least I can speak for myself. That's what I'm trying to do. But today I want to do something that's a little bit more personal. Oh, and before I start, let's share screen. So today's going to be a little more personal because I'm going to be talking about some stressful things that happened in my life and how they affected my biological age. But I'm going to start with a clip from a movie that has always resonated with me, and even more so as I'm getting older.
Because all of a sudden it's closer to the end than it is the beginning, and death is suddenly a perceptible thing to me, with definable features. You're dealing with a man that has primal doubt.
So that is from the movie Network, and it's William Holden talking to Faye Dunaway. To paraphrase Dylan Thomas, I'm not ready to go into that dark night. And to paraphrase the Monte Python.
I'm not dead. What? Nothing is, you know. I'm not dead.
Yeah. He says he's not dead.
Yes, he is.
I'm not.
He isn't?
Well, he will be soon. He's very ill.
I'm getting better.
No, you're not. You'll be stone dead in a moment.
Oh, I can't take him like that.
I like to say I'm not dead yet.
Well, and thankfully, no one watching this video will be either.
Yeah, I'm not ready to go down without a fight, but I have been paying attention to my biological age, and I've even started taking supplements, which is something that, if you know my character, you've known me a long time, something I never used to do. I never even used to like to take allergy pills or an aspirin, and now I'm taking a whole bunch of things. We're going to talk about that. And this is going to be a little bit of an introduction today about biological age and stress. I want to refer back to some of our previous videos and also kind of set up for what we're going to be talking about over the next probably 3 or 4 videos. Do you remember the movie Cocoon?
Me, yeah.
There's going to be a theme here, so pay attention to that. So there was another scene that resonated with me, and I'll set it up. The movie is about these retirees in Florida who discover a fountain of youth in a swimming pool. And
An
I think
alien egg, let's
an
be clear.
alien, yes, an alien egg in a swimming pool that causes them to feel young again. And it's kind of ironic because Ponce de Leon was searching for the fountain of youth in Florida. So maybe it really is in Florida. Maybe
I sense a multiverse crossover coming. The Ponce de Leon alien egg
we're going to talk about the Emperor of
predator.
China and even include the Simpsons and the Family Guy. So here we go with
Okay.
that. Here we go with that other clip that
I'm
resonated.
going on the ride.
It is the miracle of everlasting life.
We'll never be sick. We won't get any older, and we won't ever die.
Wilford Brimley, do you know who he is?
I mean, now he's known as the oatmeal guy or the. Something like that.
The idea is there's no fountain of youth, and if there's no way to slow down or reverse age, maybe at least there's a way to try to make you feel younger. And that's kind of what happens in the movie, right? They get in the pool and they start to feel their younger selves. And I had these stressful events happen. One of the things I've always been good at is the physical training part. And one of the things I've always not been so good at is dealing with stress and mental health. So I've finally seen how important that connection is, and been able to measure it with the biological age test that I'm taking and some other things that I've been doing. So Wilford Brimley, speaking of immortality, he had a certain amount of internet immortality, and it had to do with how old he was when that film was made. He looked a lot older than he was when he was the youngest guy who played one of the retirees. He was really only in his 50s. And so there's this thing called the Wilford Brimley line. And you can calculate how old you are when you reach that line on one website. And on another, they post pictures of celebrities. Here's Eminem when he was younger and when he reached the Wilford, it's called the Brimley Cocoon line. So when he was the same age as Wilford Brimley was in that movie, they post a picture so you can compare how old they look relative to Wilford Brimley when he was that age, which is a little unfair because Brimley, well, first of all, they made him up to look older. Tom Cruise and Wilford Brimley at the same age. They dyed his hair and they put some makeup on him to make him look older. But the other thing is he had diabetes. And that definitely affects your age. And, you know, it's questionable, and we're going to be talking about this, whether or not we can slow down or reverse aging. But one thing we know can happen is you can age faster, right? There are things that we know will make us age faster. Smoking will do that. Drinking will do that. Too much time in the sun will do that. The question is whether or not you can reverse these hallmarks of aging, like gray hair, for example. But anyway, Brimley had his internet immortality to the point where people were either talking about how he looked older than he was.
Happy that you came here. I'm a big fan of your work, you know.
Well, thank you.
You know what I was amazed at, though? I was looking at your resume today.
Yeah.
And when you did Cocoon, you were the same age as I am now.
Okay.
So there's a theme here. Yeah. William Holden, for example, in the movie Network, when he did that scene, was younger than I am now. But he looked decades older because he smoked and he drank. So anyway, this whole thing about whether you look your age or not, I think of Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. Tim Walz is 6 months older than she is.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, does look a lot older than he is, right? Anyway, the other thing that Brimley became famous for was the way that he pronounced diabetes.
Hi, I'm Wilford Brimley, and I have diabetes.
Hi. I'm Wilford Brimley, and I've had diabetes for about 20 years.
So, as a result of having had made the decision to take supplements to see if it could help slow down my biological aging, I should say, the things that I've been doing, working out, eating right, and all those things, I went ahead and took a biological age test because I wanted to see if they were working. And my biological age was significantly younger than my chronological age. And then I had these stressful things that happened to me all at once, three of them. And all of a sudden, my biological age skyrocketed. And now it's coming back down again. I'm going to keep measuring it over time. But the important thing is I realized that the only thing that changed was that I had these stressful events happen. I was surprised that it had the kind of impact that it did. So I've been working on things to try to improve my ability to manage stress and to deal, you know, mental health things. And I came upon the work of a professor at Harvard who studies mindfulness. And I'm going to do another pop culture thing here for you. Did you ever see The Simpsons where Grandpa Simpson goes with the family to Cuba?
Probably, but I don't really remember it.
All right. So he gets in an old car and it makes him feel his younger self.
It's the car. All our American cars were built before 1960. And studies show that exposure to objects from your youth can help to feel young again.
What studies? Are they peer-reviewed?
You know what they are? A professor, Ellen Langer, did a study where seniors exposed to culture from the 50s became more vigorous and engaged. They even engaged in heavy bed.
So I don't know if you heard that last part, but he says...
Oh, yeah, I did.
It's not true, by the way. That didn't happen in the study. The studies weren't, in fact, peer-reviewed. And this is something I want to talk about. She did this famous study where she had these older people live in this environment where it was during their youth. Everything around them was supposed to bring them back to the time when they were younger. And supposedly they felt younger as a result of being in this experiment. But she didn't think anybody would believe it, so she never published her work, so it never got reviewed. And it's become famous in spite of that fact, maybe partly because of that fact. There was at one point somebody was going to replicate the experiment, and they, for whatever reason, they proposed it and they didn't actually do it. So, but I think it's an interesting idea because there's, you know, it's important. It's not just whether or not we can measure some biological age, hallmarks of biological age, like gray hair or wrinkles or something like that. It's mostly about how we feel, right? The reason that we are trying to stay active is it's less so that we can have a longer life or a healthier life. It's more so that we can feel better on a day-to-day basis, right? So back in episode 5, the 12 tools, we introduced the biologist Satchin Panda and the circadian code. And that's where we talked about the concept of time-restricted eating. And by the way, I wanted to call Panda the first of a cast of characters that I want to talk about, but you didn't want to use cast of characters. You wanted to say experts. The reason that I hesitated to use experts is because when you cite a source that, for whatever reason, has, you know, a Harvard professor or whatever, that's a logical fallacy, right? That doesn't necessarily mean that they're right. You may be able to make a stronger argument when you have good sources, but it's not necessarily true.
It's only a fallacy when they claim expertise not in their field. So, for example, I had a colleague at PolyU who was a PhD in electrical engineering, mm-hmm. and wound up teaching mindfulness and, you know, enlightenment and all of this. That's a logical mm-hmm. fallacy. But if he had opinions on electrical engineering, that's not a logical fallacy.
Well,
I was trying. So with the avoidance of cast of characters, I'm tacitly trying to avoid so-called experts. I don't even want to talk about them. They're ridiculous.
Well, one of the people I want to talk about is an influencer. He's not an expert at all. He's an actual tech bro. But anyway, Panda is a biologist. And he is the acknowledged expert in the field of circadian rhythms. And we included time-restricted eating in our 12 tools as a result of me coming upon his work. And it wasn't just his work. It was his work and the work of others. I'm going to include the studies. I want to talk about these individual people and their work in the longevity field over the next few videos. In episode 10, One Meal a Day, we introduced, I'm going to call him Tech Bro Brian Johnson of Do Not Die. So if you're watching this video, you've probably heard of Brian Johnson, and he is somewhat controversial, but he mocks himself, and I think he's kind of entertaining. And some of the things that he does, I actually believe in, I agree with him on. Other things are questionable. He's done some questionable things in his quest to try to live forever, supposedly, or at least live more than 125 years, I think was his original goal. I don't know if I want to live that old, but I do want to live longer. Like I said, I'm not ready to go yet. I'm not going down without a fight. I want to live to fight another day.
And if life is also fighting, I'm not sure that's such a good idea, but okay, let's keep going.
So anyway, in episode 10, we introduced Brian Johnson and also David Sinclair, who is a geneticist, and his book, Why We Age and Why We Don't Have to. Both of them have their critics, but again, I want to talk about those in the future episodes. Oh, and the Emperor of China. Did you know that he might have died from mercury poisoning at the age of 39?
Are you kidding?
Why was he taking mercury?
Have you met me?
All right. Why was he taking mercury?
Longevity.
Yeah, exactly. He's looking for a fountain of youth. It goes back a ways. Isaac Newton, others. So yeah, and then I also want to talk about why I joined telehealth and why I'm taking these biological age tests and the results that I've been getting. And in episode 11, keto, ice baths, and other fads, we introduced the medical doctor and clinician, Peter Attia, who wrote Outlive, and also the longevity researcher Nir Barzilai, the author of Age Later. So the reason I pointed out that Peter Attia is a clinician is unlike most of the longevity experts, he's an actual practicing physician who has a clinic and patients that he monitors. So he's a little closer to it than somebody who just studies large groups of people. Barzilai, on the other hand, is an actual gerontologist who is famous for, among other things, a study of people who lived to be 100 and is now involved in the TAME study where they're looking at using metformin. And these are the things I want to talk about. There's a lot of buzz about NAD, about the use of rapamycin or metformin and that sort of thing. Right now, I'm not taking anything other than some supplements, which I'm going to list on our website and what I want to talk about over the next 3 videos. And also, there are some recent studies in cell metabolism about how biological age can be increased by stress. Several studies, actually. One of them is famous because they actually measured somebody's hair. Did we talk about this?
Not specifically, but I do hope you'll put all of these papers or links to these papers on the website.
I'm going to do that. I'm going to put all
the research page, which we have nicely curated.
So one of the things that they did is they measured someone's hair, gray hair, and I'm going to put a link in the webpage. Okay. So
they used an electron microscope?
Yes, they did. So basically, person had normal hair color. They had a stressful event. Their hair turned gray. They gave them the tools to deal with the stress, and their hair color came back. I think it's interesting.
Yeah.
Again, it's what they call a hallmark of aging. It's not necessarily proof that there's anything you can do about reducing biological age, but it's evidence that there might be the possibility of it. All right. So before I took the supplements, I took my biological age test, but at the bottom here, April 4th of last year, you'll see that my biological age, they call this the delta, was 3 years and 7 months younger than my chronological age. And one of the things this company does, and I should say up front, they are not sponsoring us. They're not a sponsor. The reason I chose them, by the way, is because of, again, this is the appeal to authority fallacy. I admire the work of David Sinclair. I understand the reason for his critics, but I trust him. And he started this company that does 2 things. They produce these biological age tests at a much more affordable price than they used to be. He's helping to accomplish that task. I know he's doing it for a profit motive, but he's still doing something positive. And the other thing that they do is they produce these supplements. Now, at least one of the critics would say the same company that's giving you the biological age test shouldn't also be selling you the supplements. However, my biological age went up after I started taking the supplements. So I'm not sure I believe that argument altogether, but anyway, before I started taking any supplements, I was doing pretty good. My biological age was 3 years and 7 months younger than my chronological age. Then I added the supplements to my regime. And again, I'm going to put these in the links. And it improved. Oh, and by the way, the lifestyle score, one of the things that they do is they when you register your test, they give you a survey to fill out. And so you can measure whether or not you've made other improvements. The problem with these are they are self-reported. And this is the same problem that you have with large studies with large population groups where people are filling out surveys. They're self-reported. So what I put today might be different than what I put tomorrow, depending on what I can remember and how I'm feeling. Not to mention the fact that these things change over time, but it's still useful, I think. So I started taking the supplements. My biological age went down, which is what I was hoping it would do. But then I went from here to here. Are you able to see that?
Mm-hmm.
But then I had 3 discrete, very stressful events happen in my life. And the next time I took the test, despite the fact that I was still exercising, despite the fact that I was taking all these supplements, it jumped up to nearly matching my chronological age. So I started working on, and so it went to 0 years and 11 months, my lifestyle score. So I started working, I looked at Ellen Langer and her mindfulness study and started doing some other things. You and I have been talking about that, about yoga and meditation and other techniques to try to moderate how the negative effects that stress has on your health. And I saw an improvement, but I'm struggling. So I'm still working on these things and it's improved a little bit. It's now a year and 5 months less than my chronological age, but there are 2 things I'm going to do. I'm going to keep trying to work on these techniques to improve my stress management and see what that does. But then I also might do an experiment at some point where I stop taking the supplements to see what that does.
Yep.
So your thoughts?
My quick reaction is, you know, first is the profound one, right? Like, what are you going to do with all that extra time anyway? Isn't that the more important thing? Like, all of these efforts to live longer seem to leave a huge question unanswered. And I think that philosophically, that's quite important. The other thing is that so many of these things are just not shown, not proven, and they are so-called effects and aspects. I think you recently got Good to Great, or not Good to Great, that's my other favorite business book, Good to Go. And in this book, the scientist, yes, reviews, the scientist reviews a whole bunch of things about recovery. In fact, many of the things you just mentioned, supplements, ice baths, you know, cryotank cooling, all sorts of things, and finds time and again that they're just not actually effective and not proven in any way. Interestingly, though, she does find crossover, as you're pointing out, some of the mental health aspects. Again, they take out everything. She debunks lactic acid. She debunks like all the things you've ever heard about ever in physical exercise and recovery, debunks all of that, including mindfulness. Because it turns out that many people then just obsess about, am I mindfuling now? And then wind up distracting themselves because they're trying too hard to be mindful. But interestingly, relaxation and, you know, down system or nervous system downregulation, but leaning into the other, you know, the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, being able to lean into that recovery one actually helps. And so the only treatment, what you and I would probably call isolation chambers, but now apparently people call them float pods. Mm-hmm. And it is the ability to calm yourself over the course of an hour with, because you don't have anything to do, like nearly literally, like no sensory inputs. Mm-hmm. You've set mm-hmm. aside your hour to just sit there. Obviously, it's going to have the same problems as mindfulness, because some people will just panic. I mean, claustrophobes, for example, being right. locked into a little pod will freak right out. But I think, so that's the only active thing you could be doing that turns out to bear any weight. And time and again, she points to the natural systems that your body uses, mm-hmm. and that the only things that really matter are nervous system downregulation, either through sleep, rest, mm-hmm. or things like a deprivation pod. That's it. Everything else is just basic stuff, like sleep regularly and sleep as much as you can, eat a well-rounded diet, take care of your mental thing, make sure your resolve and your actions in the world align with your values, and that's kind of it. Mm-hmm. All the rest of these scientists that you're going to spend some time introducing us to, and please do spend a minute here telling us how the next episodes are going to be.
Yeah, I want to talk about whether epigenetic age is a meaningful number, how stress...
Hint, hint, it's not.
How stress has an impact on it, and what you can do about it, or at least what I'm trying to do about it, what you might be trying to do about it. And I want to talk about these longevity experts, scientists, and a tech bro, and the supplements and drugs that they're taking and not, and why I agree with some of it and why I don't agree with some other parts of it, and my arguments for them.
Yeah, so it's going to be fun. You're going to tell us all about the things that you're actually trying and doing self-experiments on. And that sounds like I'll play the role of contrarian and fact checker.
Absolutely.
Maybe philosopher and scientist.
I'm going to count on you for that.
Oh, all right, then we're in real trouble.
So remember to do hard things, go outside, and keep moving forward.
We'll see you out there, breaking impossible.